Hey, welcome to church. We're glad you've joined us here at First United Methodist Church in Gladewater, Texas. It is great to be with you, even though we are still virtual. It's great to be together. Appreciate it if you would comment below that you're here and that you're watching. And if you have any thoughts, comments, questions during the service, post them below. We watch, me and Beth watch as it's being posted. And so we'll respond back, and we have a nice little dialogue. So thanks for being here. Couple of announcements. We met as an ad board on Thursday, and the administrative board decided that we will remain closed through the month of May. Because of health concerns and just the unknown right now of this whole COVID-19 situation and reopening Texas, we don't want to take any chances. We love each other too much to hurt each other. So we will remain closed for worship, and the office will be closed. We'll still be working remotely throughout the month of May, and we'll reevaluate the last week of May to see what we do come June. I will be talking to small group leaders, Bible study leaders, Sunday school leaders this week, and we will be trying to start back some of those smaller group meetings, but no worship in-house for the month of May. I believe those are the only significant announcements. If you have any questions, if you need anything, please give us a call at the church number. It is forwarded to Gail's phone, so we can answer that anytime. Let's worship, shall we?
Thank you.
now time to go to the Lord in prayer. If you have any prayer requests, please email them to us or post them below or direct message us on our Facebook or Instagram page. But please let us know those requests. Everyone should have got an updated prayer request list either mailed through the regular mail or emailed to them this week that went out with the mottos. So be on the lookout for that. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Holy Father, we thank you. We thank you that you are God. We thank you that you are in control. That you have us. That you hold us. God, thank you for listening. Thank you for caring. Lord, I pray for all those making decisions right now about their businesses, about their families, about states and nations, about churches. Lord, there's a lot going on. There's a lot of things that are up in the air. There's a lot of things that are still unknown. God, give us wisdom as we move forward. This your wisdom, not only for ourselves, but for our neighbors, for our families. Let us know what is right. Let us know what is your will in this season. God, I thank you for our administrative board that met this past Thursday. Thank you for the care and compassion that they had for one another in that meeting and that they have for their church. Lord, it wasn't fear that led to their decisions. It was grace, it was hope, and it was love. Lord, I thank you for them. Lord, I thank you for this church. I thank you that it is reaching out to one another. They are reaching out to you. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for blessing us with this chance to worship together. Even though it's still virtual, even though it's still online, we are together, in spirit and in heart. God, I ask you to be with all those that are still on the front lines. Those that continue to put themselves in harm's way each and every day to help others. Be with our doctors, our nurses, our first responders. Be with all those businesses that are now in Texas reopened. As we interact more and more with each other in the days and weeks ahead. May we do so safely. May we do so with compassion. God, be with us during these days. Continue to put your hand on us. Guide us. Lord, I pray for all those who are suffering, who experienced loss this past week. Pray for those who are still mourning and grieving the losses of their loved ones. Lord, I pray for those in the hospital. Pray for those who are isolated. God, you are with them. May we continue to reach out. May we be your hands, your feet, your mouth, and your ears. May we be your servants. Lord, I pray for your church. This church, First United Methodist Church, Claywater. Move forward in this season to begin to transition from one pastor to another. Prepare the way. Prepare this church. Prepare Bud and Debbie. Lord, we thank you for them. Thank you for Bud, who is your servant, who's been called to lead here. Lord, we thank you for this new opportunity. this new season. Lord, I thank you for all that you do. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's sing. Thanks, Sammy and the worship team, for leading us in song this morning. Really appreciate all that y'all are doing to make this possible. We're going to be in 1 Thessalonians this morning, chapter 5. It's towards the end. It's actually the last chapter in 1 Thessalonians. As you're flipping there, I'm going to give you a little background on it. It's written by the Apostle Paul, one of his official letters. He did write it, his hand, his pen. And this one's a little different. This is probably his most encouraging letter. He really liked the church in Thessalonica. They were a people that were experiencing some pressure from their community. It was a church that really had to fight its way out. It wasn't fighting amongst itself. They were together. But they were new Christians. They were young Christians. They were babies in the faith. And so he does a lot of encouraging. He does a lot of teaching. I think it's over 20 times that he talks about the resurrection of Jesus Christ in 1 Thessalonians. It's probably his first letter, like the first one he wrote, probably around 51 AD. Probably wrote it from Corinth to Thessalonica. So That's a little bit of the background. All right, so we're going to be in chapter 5. I'll be reading out of the ESV. And we're going to read 12 through 24, okay? So this will have a little bit of a end of letter benediction type feel to it, because that's what it is, all right? We ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. And we urge you, brothers, admonish the idle, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with them all. See that no one repays anyone evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely it's the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that we can open it up and read it together, because when your word is read, it brings life. It gives life. Lord, not only does it give life, but it lights our path. This is how we know who you are and what you want from us. So God, I just ask now in this time that you would speak. Speak through me to your people. May I not get in the way of what you have for us today. God, use me. Use me however you will in this time. But may you be heard above all else. Lord, I thank you for this time. I thank you for this opportunity. Be with us now. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Have you ever noticed that anybody who leads people has kind of their go-to phrases? Like, no matter the size, no matter if you are leading a group of three or a group of 3,000, the person in charge has a go-to phrase. The first one I can remember was my grandpa. When we would be working cows, meaning when we would be rounding the cows up to doctor them, vaccinate, all that stuff, his go-to phrase was, "Think like a cow." If you did something wrong, if you were in the wrong place, you didn't have the gate open at the right time, he'd ask the question, "Well, were you thinking like a cow?" "No, Paul, I wasn't thinking like a cow. I don't even know what that means." And I think to high school, and I think to my football coaches. Now, a lot of times you can't exactly quote high school football coaches in church, but they did have some that were definitely church appropriate. Mondays, going out to practice, we were usually late, and our head coach would say, "Dollar waiting on a dime, boys. Dollar waiting on a dime." Meaning he was the dollar and we were less than. Thursdays, last practice of the week, "Hay's in the barn, boys. Hay's in the barn." "What hay? We're on a practice field, coach. There's no hay. There's no barn. Most of our team couldn't even tell you what hay looked like." But my favorite, one of our assistant coaches, as soon as it got cold, and I'm talking real cold. Like in Oklahoma, you play games that it's in the 30s Winds blowing 30, 40 miles an hour. Sleet. Okay? That's the image here. Sleet on the helmets. You can see your breath. And Coach Rollins says, cold's just a state of mind, boys. Cold is just a state of mind. You tell that to the icicles forming on my goatee, Coach. No, cold is not a state of mind. But probably the phrase that has stuck with me throughout ministry was from one of my pastors, an associate pastor I worked under in college. And his go-to phrase was, just trying to help you, not trying to hurt you. And he always said this after I had done something foolish and he had to correct me because I'd just done something dumb. But he always helped me, didn't hurt me. And so we get back to Thessalonians, we get to the Apostle Paul, and he too has a phrase. His you can find starting in verse 16. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. Paul probably uses the word rejoice more than any other writer in the Bible. He says it a lot. And I got to thinking, why? I mean, when you look at Paul's life, he's constantly in trouble. He writes most of his letters from prison. He's shipwrecked. He's snake bit. He's got these churches that are either being persecuted or internal combusting. There's not a lot that goes right. I mean, it's kind of tough being the leader of this new thing. But yet, he always says, rejoice. And that hit me this week. As we're in the midst of still the unknown. We're starting to open up. Some places aren't. Some places are. We don't know whether we should go out or whether we should stay in. We don't know how active we're supposed to be. Uncertainty still. And yet I hear the Apostle Paul say, rejoice always. And so I thought about that. Because I know that life isn't rainbows and unicorns for everybody. There are bad things that happen. And yet, we're told to rejoice. And then I read down a little further. And it says, pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Now, on first look, it can just seem like that last phrase, that give thanks in all circumstances, is the will of God. But in actuality, it's all three. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances. See, when we sign up, when we put our name on the line, when we say, God, I'm yours. Our identity shifts. Our focus shifts from just me to all those around me. Our eyes change from seeing with human eyes to seeing with the eyes of Christ. So when we look at our own circumstances, maybe we don't always have something to rejoice about. Maybe there is pain. Maybe there is loss. But when we become a Christian, it's no longer just about us, but about everyone. And at any given time, in any given moment, There is always something to rejoice about in our community. Someone always has something going right. I'm always a child of God. I know what eternity holds. That's the kind of rejoicing that Paul's talking about. This rejoice always, because you always have something to rejoice about if you just look. And that's where praying without ceasing comes in. Because when we pray without ceasing, we put our eyes in the right spot. They're focused on God, not focused on the things around us. But it's higher. It's broader. It's a different perspective. And it's that perspective that carries this will. But he doesn't stop there. And honestly, I think he should have started with verse 19. As he's given this list of things that they need to do. Verse 19 says, "Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil." If he would have started with the Spirit, to me that would have made a little bit more sense. That would have focused us. That would have helped us understand that it's not just us. It's not just on me to find things to rejoice about. It's not just on me to have those eyes of Christ. It's the Spirit inside me that helps me to see that. So when it says, do not quench the Spirit, or do not stifle, or do not hinder the Spirit, it means it. When you become a Christian, you receive the Holy Spirit. It is a gift. It's what gives us strength. It's what helps us make it through the day. And it's that Spirit that helps us to see and be outside of ourselves. But there were those in this community that said no. There were those in Thessalonica that were telling the people, no, you don't have the Spirit. No, you can't have the Spirit because you're Gentiles. The Spirit's not for you. Forget it. But friends, that's a lie. You have the Spirit inside you right now. You have the ability to tap into that Spirit, to do more than you think you can, to see more than you think you can. Friends, when we tap into that Spirit, when we don't stifle, when we don't hinder it, our mindset is changed. We see the things to rejoice about. We have the strength to pray and to seek God, to hear from God. Don't stifle the Spirit, friends. Verse 20. Do not despise prophecies. Test everything. Hold fast what is good. Prophecy sometimes gets a bad rap. We think of prophecy as this crystal ball. If you're a prophet, you see the future. But that's not what it's about. Prophecy is simply hearing from God and telling the people what you heard that God wants for them. You become the messenger from God to others. It can be one person. It can be a whole group. But you have a message. It can be a message of encouragement. It can be a message of education. It can be a message of help. You can see something in someone, and God leads you to help them in that situation. But you notice what it says. Test this. Just like I said, there are people coming against this church. Just like there are people coming against the church now. There are people that fully believe when Governor Abbott opened the state on Friday, that means every church in the state of Texas should be in church on Sunday morning. If you test that, friends, I think you find that that's not God. Are there some churches that should be open? Yes. There are some communities in our state that have zero cases of corona in their whole counties. There's not a reason for them to still be closed. But where we sit, where we are, to truly love each other and love our neighbor, we stay closed. I heard passionate, compassionate voices on Thursday. People that were listening to God and doing what was best for their community and their church. That's being a prophet. That's hearing something for the good of others and sharing it. That's not evil. That's not fear. That's love. That's in the Spirit. And it's that Spirit that will connect us. It's that Spirit, it's that compassion and love that makes me rejoice. I was encouraged leaving that meeting on Thursday because I knew the people in that room, your church leaders, deeply cared and deeply thought about this church, about you and about me, about how best to show God's love. So in these times where we say, oh, the church doors are still closed, I can't rejoice. I heard people say, yeah, it's not the same when we worship online, but I can still worship. I can still sing. I can still hear a message. I can still be connected. And that gives us hope, friends. Because at the end of the day, that's really what we're rejoicing about, is the hope that we have in the love of Christ Jesus. The hope that will carry us through not only this life, but through eternity. That is worth rejoicing about. As Paul closes, verse 23. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. Friends, that's it. That's the message. God is faithful. God will do it. It may not be this week. It may not be next week. It may not be in June. But God will do it. Friends, don't let anything keep you from rejoicing this week. Find it in yourself. Find it in the spirit that is within you to find life, to find hope in the world around you. Connect with someone. Call someone. Message someone. Be present in the world. Friends, I love you. And I can't wait to get back together with you in person. But until that happens, I will rejoice knowing that hope in Jesus Christ will carry us through until then. Friends, have a great and blessed week. But be a blessing this week. Let's pray. God, I thank you for the Apostle Paul. I thank you for his words of encouragement. I thank you for his words of strength to a community that was under fire. A community that wasn't sure what was coming next. Thank you for that word for them that we now have. God, I pray for a boldness in us this week. A boldness in the spirit that you have put in us. May this week be different because we rejoice. May this week be different because we seek you in prayer. May this week be different because we live through the Spirit. God, I thank you for the hope that we have in your Son, Jesus Christ. I thank you for his life, his death, and his resurrection that gives us eternal relationship with you. God, you are so good. I thank you for all these things and so much more. Lord, be with us. Connect our hearts until we can connect again in person. Christ's name I pray. Amen. Now let's sing or pray or just listen to the words of this next song as we take this time to respond. See? friends, so glad you could worship with us today. Be on the lookout for a call or text or email from your Bible study or Sunday school teacher. I'm going to be calling them this week and asking if your group wants to meet. And I'm using the word Sunday school, but every group probably will not meet on Sundays. Just so you know what we're looking at, we decided to allow small groups to meet again within the church. That means groups of 10-ish or less. But we're going to do all those meetings in our biggest rooms. So we are only going to use the CLC, Jeter Hall, and the library for those small group meetings. So obviously we can't all meet at the same time or on the same day. So be on the lookout for those calls. And as always, if you don't feel comfortable right now getting out, that's fine. This is a no pressure situation. But the ad board has decided that we want to put these opportunities out here for us to get together. It's not Sunday morning worship, but at least it's something. So be on the lookout for those calls. Please respond. Again, if you don't feel comfortable, tell us that, so we'll know. No pressure, just an opportunity. All right, have a great and blessed week, and we'll see you online.